Penguin Random House Australia Audio proudly presents Ghost Species, written by James Bradley, narrated by Rupert Degas. All rights reserved. For Mardi and for Annabelle and Lila. The animals on the walls are the animals in our minds, and neither have yet faded from view. Stand and look at them long enough, and we may begin to grasp what they meant and why they matter. Refuse to look, and they will stay asleep, like Arthur's knights under the hill. But unlike Arthur's knights in those old legends, they won't rise up to save us in our hour of need. Nothing will rise but the roots and the tendrils growing over the remnants of our projects and our wishful thoughts, as they have done so many times before. And the bison and the ibex will still be there, deep in the rock, waiting to be found again. Paul Kingsnorth, In the Black Chamber. Some nights, when the wind is up and the power flickers and fails, she tells the child stories, as if this thread of words might be enough to bind them together, to bear them through all that is to come, like a boat or a leviathan. She knows she is not alone in despairing for what the future holds, in wanting to find ways to hold it back for as long as possible. But no matter how hard she tries, she cannot keep it at bay forever. For a time is coming. Soon. Sooner than she wants it to be, sooner than either of them will be ready, when the child will have to venture forth into the world we have made and find a way to survive. The onrush of that time, the feeling that their years together are already falling away, shadows her life. A drumbeat of loss behind the moments of joy. A reminder every instant is precious. But when they are here, isolated by the power or the wind, it is not time's flight that frightens her. Instead, it is the knowledge that the child is alone, and that one day soon, she will understand that. And so she does what mothers have done since the beginning of time, since before we were human. She draws filaments from the darkness, and weaves them together to create meaning, purpose, shape, arranging the elements to reveal the world, or perhaps to make a new one. Before the child, if you had suggested this might be something she could do, she would have laughed, told you she was not a storyteller. But in the years since the child arrived in her life, she has found the habits of breath and suspense that make a story live were already there, waiting within her, just as the eagerness for it is in the child, her capacity for rapt attention. How far back does this strand of connection go, she sometimes wonders. Did we require language to discover story, or did language evolve to sustain story? Are we the only animals that tell stories? Do the birds, the fish, the elephants, the whales and dolphins, and if they do, what shape do those stories take? For surely story is as much a way of being in the world as a way of describing it, a means of comprehending the way all that surrounds us hums through us as we live. It is not a thought she lingers on, for to consider it is to invite a different kind of grief, an awareness of what is being lost, extinguished as the animals disappear one by one, the irreplaceable wonder of their knowledge of the world wiped away with them. And so instead, she sits in the dark and rocks the child and tells her stories, tales about forests and snow, half-remembered myths about wolves and bears, fables about talking birds and singing stones, each containing some glimpse of a world they have forgotten how to see. In the daylight, she sometimes wonders how much of the power of these stories grows out of her desire for something solid, something to connect their unanchored world to the past. But at night, as she tells them, She can feel their power moving through her, and knows it is more than that, that they come from some deep place, somewhere before memory, before time. Sometimes, though, when the child is on the edge of sleep, she tells her one particular story, a story unlike the others, a story about a people long ago, a people who were not quite us. For as long as they could remember, this people had lived on the plains in Africa, moving in bands through its vast spaces, hunting and singing. Their world was a place where animals ruled, its grasslands and forests thronged by elephants and rhinoceroses so huge the earth told of their approach long before they arrived, its wetlands and rivers stalked by crocodiles, its skies filled by flocks of birds so immense they blotted out the sun. The people dreamed of the animals, dreamed themselves, weaving stories to teach those who came after them how to honor the animals, how to honor the land. Millennia passed, and the people were happy, until one day some of them grew restless and decided to head north, through the mountains and across the desert into the green lands beyond. These were new places, peopled by new creatures. Bears as tall as trees, fish as long as men that lay dreaming in the rivers, vast herds of wild horses and deer. But in time, the people learned their songs, and as the generations slipped by, they began to dream of them. And then one day, the snow began to creep south, carpeting the land and bringing the ice with it. This new world was harder than the old, but the people learned to survive, secreting themselves in the caves and dark places to wait out winters that lasted 9 months, learning to hunt the animals that came with the snow, the mammoths and the elk and the deer, crafting clothes from their furs and treasures from their bones. And through it all, they stayed true to the land, its voices, its presence. But though they could not see it, the cold was changing them, and as the millennia slipped by, they became heavier, stronger, adapting to their world just as the animals had. And when they sang the land, they knew they were part of it, that it sang them as well. And when they dreamed the world, they knew that it dreamed them as well. Until at last, they were no longer the same people, but a people who lived by firelight, a people of snow and ice. It is a story she tells only on the edge of sleep, because she does not want the child to ask her how it ends. For if she did, she would have to speak of the others, the people they had left behind in Africa, of the way they grew more numerous, more intelligent, their fingers shaping the world, crafting tools and weapons, until one day they too began to move north, through the deserts and across the mountains. In the countless millennia since the people left, the newcomers had forgotten they ever existed. So when they finally reached those distant lands, they were startled to find others already there. A people like them, but also different. Larger, stronger, wilder, their skin pale, their hair orange and brown. What did these newcomers make of their ancient relatives when they first encountered them, she wonders? Did they see them as brothers and sisters, or did they see in them the face of something different? Something lesser, monstrous even. It is said that when the Europeans first arrived on Australian shores, the Aborigines thought them ghosts. Did these newcomers think the same? Glimpse in their pale skin, the shiver of death, an intimation of the fate that awaited them? Or did they seem misshapen and bestial? All those stories of ogres and giants and trolls, their origins buried in the deep past, do they come from them? Whichever it was, the newcomers drove them back. Until finally the people who had come first were almost gone, forced back to the sea on the furthermost peninsula. And though it might have seemed that this was their end, It was not, or not quite, because they were not gone. Because there is her. Impossible Things. Later, Kate will wonder whether any of it would have happened if they'd been somewhere less isolated. Whether normality might have put a brake on their actions if they'd been closer to other people. For though in those years that very notion, normality, had already begun to bend, giving way as the planet itself began to buckle and shift, there is no doubt that up there, cut off from the rest of the world, it sometimes seemed that anything was possible, and nothing was forbidden. When she comes to look back, she will realize that this was not an accident, that even though Davis's other schemes had come to naught, this at least he had understood, planned for even, and the realization that he had manipulated them will make her feel ill. Today, though, she thinks none of this. Instead, as the helicopter shoots over the forest, its sleek shape slicing through the coiling breath of the mist that rises from the treetops, she is absorbed by the landscape beneath, its silent presence. For years now, there has been drought here. But as the canopy moves past below, there is little sign of it. Instead, the forest that carpets the hills and the enfolded flanks of the mountains with their outcrops of grey, volcanic stone looks impenetrable, primeval. Only the scurf of smoke on the horizon betrays the truth, the degree to which this landscape is already convulsing. In the seat beside her, Jay sits, unspeaking, his dark eyes focused on the view below. His silence is perhaps a sign he is anxious about what lies ahead. When the invitation arrived, Kate had recoiled from its gnomic wording, the assumption that would drop everything to head south to meet with an unidentified benefactor who was interested in discussing a mysterious project they thought the two of them would find intriguing. American, she had snorted contemptuously when she first saw the email. Or Chinese. But Jay had grinned.
We should go. After all, what's the worst that could happen? We get a few days to ourselves in Hobart. I could do with the time away, we both could.
Aware he was making an effort, she had forced herself to smile and agree. And so a week later, they are here, in a helicopter somewhere over the Tasmanian bush, heading for a rendezvous at an unknown location with a potential employer whose name they did not know. Jay twists in his seat, his attention caught by something below. She follows his gaze. At first, her eyes cannot make sense of what she is seeing. The cubic buildings scattered on the hillside are rendered almost invisible by the way their smoke-gray glass exteriors reflect the surrounding landscape, dissolving the perfection of their geometry into a mirrored infinity of grass, stone, and sky. In front of her in the cockpit, the assistant, Madison, she reminds herself, swivels in her seat and looks back, her face hidden behind her oversized sunglasses, the inscrutable armor of her pale makeup and carefully painted lips. In the 2 hours since she met them at the airport, she has offered no hint of where they are going or indeed any personal information at all.
We have to walk the last bit,
she says, lifting her voice over the roar of the rotors and engine.
Helicopters aren't permitted to approach the facility.
Jay leans forward.
Facility? What is this place? Are those buildings labs?
Madison smiles and stares over their shoulders. Kate realizes she is looking at some kind of display in her sunglasses.
You'll be given a full briefing once we're on site.
The helicopter swings around, passing over a low hill towards an open space on its far side. Jay leans back into his seat.
Who the hell are we meeting?
He says, his voice pitched low enough to ensure only Kate can hear him over the engine. Kate just shakes her head and looks out the window again. The grass flows outward in waves beneath them as they descend, exposing the bleached textures of its roots, the darker hues of earth and stone. At the last moment, the helicopter seems to hesitate, the pitch of the engine rising. Then there is a jolt as the rear wheels make contact with the ground, followed by the gentler bump of the front. A moment later, the engine spins down, the space left by the absence of its sound immense. With a practiced motion, the pilot opens the door and climbs out. Reaching up, she takes their bags one by one, then helps each of them down. As Kate climbs out, she catches a glimpse of herself reflected in the plexiglass canopy. At Jay's insistence, she dressed well, taking more care than she has in months, the black shirt and dark jeans she has chosen emphasizing her lean figure. Yet when she looks at her face, its thinness beneath her pulled back blonde hair, emphasized by her scrubbed skin and hollow cheekbones, all she sees are her eyes, lost, numb, emptied out. Picking up her bag, she stares up the hillside, while she waits for Jay to arrange himself. Dully grateful, she packed lightly and is not required to drag a suitcase over the ground. Once Jay has his bags, Madison heads off up the slope, moving remarkably sure-footedly given she is wearing heels, Jay beside her. Kate watches them ascend for a second or two, and then follows, a few meters behind. The hill is high enough to block the view of the facility, or Kate realizes to block the facility's view of the landing area, so it is only as she reaches the top that she has a chance to observe it properly. Seen from ground level, it is, if anything, even more beautiful than it was from the air. Its interconnected cubes seem to float above the hillside opposite, as weightless and inscrutable as some kind of alien artifact. Jay stops to let Kate catch up with him.
"Who do you think designed this place?" he asks.
Kate glances at him. He's easily seduced by wealth. But before she can answer, a strange cry echoes across the hillside, a strangled howl like nothing she has heard before. She stares around. "What was that?" she asks. Jay shrugs.
"A bird? Some kind of possum?"
Kate stares at him. Jay is a creature of the city, his interactions with wild animals in the bush confined to the occasional documentary, yet even so she cannot believe he is not at least slightly unsettled by the sound. Ahead of them, Madison is already halfway down the hill. Adjusting her bag on her shoulder, Kate stares across the open space towards the building one more time, the cloud-filled surfaces of its mirrored walls depthless, unbounded. Then she adjusts her bag on her shoulder, and heads down after Madison, Jay beside her. Madison stops by the base of the nearest cube. Where its cantilevered shape meets the hillside, a door is cut into its side, the outline almost invisible. Beside it, a small panel is set into the surface at chest height. Madison waves a hand in front of the panel, and the door slides open. Stepping aside, she motions to Kate and Jay to enter. Inside is an entrance area, its double height space subtly illuminated to emphasize its simplicity, the way its stark lines are rendered calming, even comfortable by the perfection of its dimensions. One of Kate's colleagues once joked that you always know you're in the presence of real money, corporate money, when there is no sign of advertising. An observation that comes back to Kate as they're led through the space and up a staircase into an open area above. Unlike the quiet atmosphere of the entrance area, this second space has the hushed power of a stone circle or temple. Unfurnished, save for a long table in its center and a pair of chairs to one side, its angles direct the eye to narrow floor-to-ceiling windows set into the walls, each of which frames a different slice of the landscape. Kate comes to a halt. Off to one side, somebody moves. Kate turns to see a male figure standing by one of the windows. As if Kate's attention were some kind of signal, he steps into the light, his pale eyes focused on her and Jay. Kate hesitates, aware he is familiar but unable to place him. He is young, no more than 30 or perhaps 35, with tousled blonde hair and the narrow frame and large-eyed, slightly ungainly features of a 1960s pop star. although under the rumpled Nirvana t-shirt he wears, his body looks well maintained. He stops in front of them, and as he does, Kate realizes who he is. Davis Hucken, tech billionaire, founder of Gather, the social network whose user base now surpasses those of Instagram and Twitter combined. Next to her, Jay has fallen still.
You came,
Davis says, opening and closing his hands as he speaks.
I was worried you might change your minds.
His voice is oddly pitched, almost adolescent, its carefully neutral Californian tones not quite disguising the edge of something harder beneath. Still startled, Kate realizes she remembers reading about him buying large areas of land here in Tasmania, supposedly because of its relative isolation and potential resilience in an unstable world.
This place belongs to you?
She asks. Davis blinks.
Technically, it belongs to the Hucken Foundation, but yes, I suppose so.
Kate keeps her face blank.
What is it, some kind of retreat?
Davis smiles again, his expression unreadable. There is, she sees now, something odd about his affect and awkwardness, as if his reactions are not natural, but somehow acquired.
What do you know about the Foundation?
Kate and Jay exchange a glance. Jay steps forward.
A little. It's an offshoot of Gather, a kind of charitable or benevolent arm of the main organization. You've been funding the creation of seed banks and genetic repositories, and giving money to a whole range of environmental programs, a lot of them in developing countries. I'm pretty sure I read about something to do with river dolphins in the Amazon just recently, and the coral restoration program in East Africa. Also, I know you were involved in the work Narayan and her team have done tweaking plankton DNA up in Alaska.
That's correct. The Narayan project in particular has been a huge success, and we have 12 of the repositories now, all fully self-sufficient and capable of surviving 10,000 years without maintenance. We're also working on repositories for cultural materials, artifacts, literature, music, technology. Again, all designed to last 100 centuries.
Kate doesn't speak. This kind of talk has always made her uncomfortable. The very qualities people like Davis find so intoxicating, seeming arrogant and preening to her.
But there's another strand to our work, one that's less public.
Davis glances at Madison.
Have they signed the non-disclosure agreements?
Madison checks her screen and tells them they have. Davis nods. Turning away from them, he moves back towards the window and stares out. Looking at his slim figure silhouetted in the light, Kate is struck by the disconcerting sense that they are watching a rehearsed performance, as if he is acting out a private TED video. Or is it just that he has so internalized this mode of performance it has become second nature?
When we set up the foundation, we thought we were in the business of saving things, of doing what we could to stop what we have disappearing. That's why we built the repositories. The seeds and biological material stored in them mean we have a safeguard that will allow the planet and us to survive an extinction-level event.
Like an asteroid?
Jay asks. Davis turns back to them. His eyes are a colorless blue, combined with his sandy hair and pale lashes, they make him seem almost transparent.
Did you see the news this morning?
Jay and Kate look at one another.
The last white rhino. Gone.
Kate nods.
I saw, but what does that have to do with this facility? Let me tell you a story. 100,000 years ago, there was megafauna all over the world. Woolly rhinoceroses and mammoth and elk in Europe and Asia, giant sloths and saber-toothed tigers and monster armadillos in the Americas, huge marsupials and massive reptiles here in Australia. But then about 80 or 90,000 years ago, they began to disappear. If you plot those disappearances on a map, it looks like a wave.
washing across the world, following the migration of our ancestors across the planet's surface. Some places lasted longer. In America, the megafauna survived until 12,000 years ago. In New Zealand, the moas and the giant eagles lasted until about 600 years ago. In the southern oceans, the whales and the seals survived until the beginning of the 19th century. But wherever you look, these collapses coincided with the arrival of Homo sapiens.
He stops and stares at them both for a second or two.
And the megafauna was just the beginning. In the past 50 years, we've killed 2/3 of the wildlife on Earth. The handful of megafauna species that survived our arrival, the elephants, the giraffes, the rhinos, are almost gone. Bird numbers are in free fall. Insect populations and ocean ecosystems are collapsing. And that's only going to get worse. We're on track for, what, 4 degrees? 5? 6? I was in the Arctic last week at an archaeological dig near Alakanuk in the Yukon. A decade ago, the permafrost was only a few centimeters below the surface. Now it's a meter down. The ground is collapsing. There are fires on the tundra. Fires. This last winter, it barely snowed. The sea ice is almost gone. We're not at a tipping point. We're past the tipping point. The world we knew, it's over. Our civilization is already dead. The question now isn't how to save what we had. It's how we make something new. Obviously, part of that process is technological. We need to develop better energy systems, more effective farming techniques, better ways of managing water. But if we're concentrating on that, we're missing the big picture. This isn't just about technology or economics or politics. It goes deeper than all of them. We have to accept that the old binaries, nature and technology, the human and the environmental, no longer make sense. That it's up to us to re-engineer the world.
You're talking about what? Jay asks. Genetic engineering? Synthetic biology? Biotech?
Partly. We're working on engineered species. Plants that will sequester carbon dioxide, plankton that absorb acids to help slow down ocean acidification, corals and mangrove species that grow faster and are more tolerant of temperature variation. But that won't be enough.
Jay and Kate must look confused because Davis smiles.
Come with me. I want to show you something.
He crosses to a window and waves his hand in front of the wall. With a soft whir, the glass slides away to reveal a narrow balcony. Davis steps out and gestures to the two of them to follow him. The balcony looks out along the valley, offering a view of the hillside, the dark line of the trees above, the grassy space beyond the last of the cubes. On the ground just beneath it, a stand of eucalypts has taken root in the lee of a broken hump of stone, their pale limbs twisted, warped, and wizened by the wind. Kate folds her arms against the chill, but Jay is so focused on Davis he seems not to notice. Davis looks up the slope.
It won't be long.
A moment later, the cry Kate heard earlier echoes out again. Only this time it fades away to become a series of strangled yelps. Stepping closer to the edge of the balcony, she closes her hand around the timber railing, suddenly alert. For several seconds, nothing happens. Then a lean shape appears from the trees above. It pauses briefly, then lopes down towards them. A second or two later, another appears, and then another, the three flowing down the hill together like a pack until they reach the stand of eucalypts. At first, Kate thinks they must be dogs, but then she registers their curious gait and the black stripes on their backs, and gasps.
How?
She manages to say. When?
3 years ago.
Kate nods, only half hearing him. Davis whistles, and the three creatures look up as one, and then dart around the base of the eucalypts towards them.
Davis picks up a bucket that stands against the wall of the building and extracts a piece of meat, holding it up so they can see if he waits for a moment, and tosses it down to them. They shoot forward, growling and snapping, but the largest is too quick. Clutching the meat in its jaws, it backs away, dragging the other two after itself until they finally relinquish. With a shake of its head, the victor jogs away and drops its prize on the ground. Davis slings another hunk of meat after the first, and the remaining pair fall on it, snapping and snarling. Kate cannot take her eyes off them. Although they are right in front of her, her mind rebels at the sight of them, their presence weird, unnatural, like glimpsing dinosaurs or aliens. Yet unlike the jerky film of the last specimen pacing around its cage in the 1930s, they are pulsing, alive, and perhaps most unsettlingly, fitted to the landscape. Davis throws down a third piece of meat, watching impassively as they leap on it. And then from somewhere up the hill, there are voices. Beneath them, the creatures freeze, listening. Somebody laughs, and as one, the three of them turn and lope away, disappearing back into the trees like ghosts. Kate and Jay stare at one another. Kate is not sure whether she is horrified or elated, but Jay's eyes are wide with delight.
"It's incredible," he says. "People have been talking about de-extincting thylacines for years, but you've actually done it."
He hesitates, and Kate can see him turning the possibilities over in his mind.
"Obviously, they're a good choice, relatively intact genetic material, living analogs, but still they look healthy, self-sustaining."
He pauses.
"What did you use to gestate them, devils?" "Dunarts. Although because they're born relatively undeveloped and raised in the pouch, we also created an artificial pouch based on the design of humidicribs."
"Are they fertile?" Kate asks. Davis inclines his head.
"That's been more complicated, but yes, we believe so."
She glances back up the slope to where the creatures disappeared. She can feel Davis watching her. She knows she should be excited, exultant even, but she is afraid to give way to the feeling, afraid of where it will lead.
"And they're living wild?"
"We raise them with as little human contact as possible."
"Is this why you want us?" Kate asks. "So we can help you recreate, what, dodos? Orcs?"
Davis shakes his head.
"I said before that the time had come for us to realize we are no longer separate from nature, that the binary between nature and technology no longer makes sense. What surrounds us is a new nature, one in which humans play an active part."
"By resurrecting extinct species?"
Davis smiles.
"When I first thought of this program, I imagined it would be a way of saving species that were in danger of extinction. Even if the technology wasn't there for resurrection yet, it would be soon, and at the very least, we could preserve the genetic information, provide the infrastructure for when it eventually did become feasible. We now know we can do more than just pull species back from the brink. We can actually reverse extinction, resurrect species that were lost decades, even centuries ago."
"But,"
Kate prompts him,
"the problem is that until now, our horizons have been too limited. The damage we've done to the planet doesn't go back 50 years or 100 or even 500. It goes back millennia. That means it isn't enough to bring species back. Animals don't make sense in isolation. They only make sense as part of a living whole. That means that if we're going to do this, we need to do more than resurrect individual animals, individual species. We need to reconstruct entire ecosystems."
"I don't understand. What are you proposing? Geoengineering?"
"In the first instance, as you perhaps know, we have several facilities in Russia and Canada. As the Arctic warms, the forest is spreading north, covering what used to be tundra.
The trees are darker than grasses, so that increases the albedo and makes the land absorb more heat.
Which is causing the permafrost to melt faster, Jay says. Davis looks at him and blinks.
That's correct. And as the permafrost melts, the methane that is locked up in it is being released, hastening the warming that's already taking place. If we can't slow that down, it's game over for the climate.
But how do the thylacines fit into that? Kate asks. Davis smiles.
A few years ago, there was a project to reintroduce wolves to Yellowstone. At first, they thought the wolves would help control the number of deer and other herbivores in the park. But as the population of herbivores fell, so did their impact on the banks of the streams, meaning the rivers began to change course and grow more winding. Before long, beavers moved back in as well, creating ponds and waterfalls and new habitat for fish and other species. Within a few years, the entire landscape was transformed. What that study demonstrated was that reintroducing even one species can have profound effects on the landscape. In the case of the tundra, it's mostly grassland, which is a relic of the last ice age, but the grasses only exist because large herbivores prevent the forest from taking root. Those large herbivores are now almost gone, meaning the forest is free to spread. But as the example of the wolves demonstrates, if we can reintroduce large herbivores, we can recreate the conditions of the last ice age and keep the forest at bay,
thereby slowing or even preventing the release of the greenhouse gases in the permafrost, Jay says. Davis nods.
Precisely.
When you say large herbivores, what do you have in mind? Reindeer? Elk? Moose?
Musk oxen, aurochs, mammoths, and the Arctic is just the beginning. We need to reconstruct ecosystems all over the planet, rebuild what's been lost, what we've destroyed.
There is a moment of silence. Jay glances at Kate. He is smiling, his excitement palpable.
You think what you're describing is possible? He asks.
Davis pauses, then takes a step forward.
We know it's possible. Ecosystems are really just cycles of energy. We have the computational power to model them, to understand the way energy flows through them. But I want you for something else.
Kate shifts uncomfortably, but Davis is not finished.
The further we've come with this project, the clearer it's become that resurrecting lost species and recreating ecosystems is just the beginning. We're talking about entirely re-engineering our relationship with nature. But to do that, we need to reimagine ourselves, the way we think, the sorts of attitudes that have got us where we are. We're so used to the dichotomies between human and nature, the individual and the whole, we can barely imagine the world without them. But we have to. And if we're going to do that, we need to let go of the idea we're distinct, separate, unique.
Kate and Jay glance at one another.
I don't understand, Kate says.
Yes, you do,
Davis says, staring at her. Kate hesitates.
You're talking about creating other human species?
Davis nods.
Not creating, recreating.
You mean what? Neanderthals? Denisovans?
Davis smiles. To begin with.
Why?
As he smiles again, Kate feels the uneasy prickle of something. Charm. Or perhaps the power to change the world that often passes for it.
Because we can. Because it gives us the chance to undo the wrong that was done when they were wiped out. But also because we need them. The world needs them. Look at the earth, at what our carelessness has done to it. We can't let that happen again. We need to be tested by other minds, other perspectives. We need to learn how other eyes see the world.
Think what we could learn from them, from their minds. Imagine speaking to another species.
Kate shakes her head in disbelief.
Without an evolutionary context, a community, they wouldn't be another species. They'd be an exhibit, an experiment. All we'd see when we looked into their eyes would be a reflection of our own hubris.
Davis gives her an oddly blank look.
Perhaps, at first. But you know as well as I do that the nature of life is to adapt, to change.
Even if you could reassemble the genetic material, you would require human surrogates, says Jay, as well as human eggs. And I can't begin to imagine how you'd get ethical clearance. Human cloning is banned in almost every country in the world.
Kate looks at him in dismay, aware from his tone of voice that he is thinking the idea through, weighing its possibilities. But he does not notice.
We've already had some very productive conversations with both state and federal governments, so we're confident that suitable exemptions can be arranged.
But what about the scientific community? Kate asks. They're likely to have significant objections as well.
Davis smiles.
That won't be an issue. The arrangements we've made with the relevant authorities are confidential.
And they agree to that?
These are exceptional times. They call for exceptional measures.
Kate hesitates at this non-answer. In recent years, Gather has come under attack for its business practices, with widespread allegations its executives have manipulated government policy through lobbying and donations. Jay gives her a warning glance.
You'd also need significant resources, she says. That shouldn't be a problem.
I still don't see where we fit in, she counters.
Davis blinks.
Don't you? You two know as much about human genetics as anybody alive. Your work as a genetic programmer is without parallel. And Jay's recombinant techniques have shown remarkable results. Why not use the team behind your thylacines? They're working on the Arctic project. Making mammoths?
Davis nods.
Among other things?
Jay steps forward. You must know that what you're talking about is orders of magnitude more complicated than thylacines or mammoths, and the level of failure that can be tolerated is much lower.
Yes, Davis agrees. That's why I want the two of you.
As he speaks, he turns to Kate. For several seconds, there is silence.
And you know I have problems at present,
she says in a flat voice.
Everybody has setbacks, Davis says. I've had them as well. They're how we learn.
Like evolution, Jay says. Kate glares at him, her stomach lurching in disbelief. But Jay only smiles. Davis smiles.
Exactly. Now perhaps I could show you the rest of the facility?
That night they eat alone, seated in the room in which Davis was waiting when they arrived. The meal is delivered by black uniformed staff. And when they are done, they retire to a suite in one of the residential cubes, a pair of austerely beautiful rooms whose lofty ceilings and subdued lighting would not be out of place in a luxury hotel.
Do you think he means what he says?
Kate asks, once they are alone.
That the world can be re-engineered?
Jay unbuttons his shirt and hangs it on the back of a chair.
When you have his kind of money, almost anything is possible.
Kate gestures at the walls, the delicate play of light upon them. Their concrete surfaces bear the imprints of the timber palings used to mold them. The effect subtly softening the geometric simplicity of the structure, making what might otherwise be cold and stark, warm and organic.
With what this will cost, he could do other things, though. Improve conditions in Africa or India, invest in education, help reduce poverty.
It's too late for that, Jay counters. We don't need change in a generation. We need it now. Hell, we needed it 20 years ago. What Davis is talking about is a way of leapfrogging past all that, of creating the beginnings of a new world, one where we can do all the things you're talking about.
But he's talking about making people, about playing God.
Look at the world, what we're doing to it. We've been playing God for a long time. Perhaps what Davis is doing is offering us a chance to do that consciously.
And what will happen to these children if we make them? Who will raise them? Who's going to teach them? Where will they belong? We both know people who won't have kids because they don't want to bring children into this world. How is this different?
Because this has the potential to change everything. I mean, imagine the possibility of encountering another species, one that sees the world differently from us. Imagine what that might mean, how it might change the way we see the planet. Imagine connecting us to our deep past like that.
Are you sure you want to be connected to that past?
Kate asks. What do you mean?
We exterminated them.
Jay laughs.
Exactly. Which is all the more reason to do this. This is our chance to undo that mistake, to give them another chance. And anyway, Davis is right. Imagine what we could learn from them. If it can even be done.
It can be done, Jay says. You know it can be done.
You don't think you're underestimating the technical problems? Where do we get the genetic material? How do we implant it? How do we bring the child to term?
We can work it out. With the resources Davis has at his disposal, we can work anything out.
But it isn't just about the technical problems, is it? This is a life we're talking about, a child.
Davis will do it anyway, Jay says. If we do it for him, perhaps we can learn something. Perhaps we can control it. She shakes her head.
That's your gambit? If we don't do it, somebody else will? Really?
Jay stares at her for a long moment. Are you sure we're talking about the same thing here? She returns his stare.
What?
She asks, incredulous. I know this isn't a great time for you, that this can't be easy. Kate stares at him coldly. Aware he has overplayed his hand, Jay hesitates. I'm sorry, he says. But you know what I mean.
Get fucked, Jay,
she says, her voice low and hard.
I just want to be sure.
She glares at him.
All right,
she says at last.
I'll think about it.
Standing up, she walks into the bathroom and, closing the door, sits down on the edge of the bath to steady herself. She is shaking, and when she closes her eyes, she can taste bile in her throat. It is only when the trembling finally subsides that she stands and, approaching the sink, brushes her teeth and washes her face, moving through these rituals wordlessly, mechanically, as if it might be possible to erase herself in their repetition. Once she is done, she returns to the room and undresses in silence, aware of Jay watching her. But when she climbs into the vast expanse of bed, she does not turn to face him or reach out to touch him, unwilling to let the distance between them be bridged. It has not always been like this between them. When they first met 7 years ago, Kate had just returned from California for an interview. She was in two minds about the job. When she left Sydney a decade earlier, she had done so without regret, and the thought of returning to a place where her old life was so close at hand made her uneasy. Yet the prospect of a 5-year research appointment was too attractive to pass up. Their first encounter was at the lecture she was required to give as part of the selection process. She was nervous, keenly aware her years away and lack of contacts had made her an outside candidate, but after deciding to emphasize her research profile by approaching the lecture relatively formally, she was dismayed to realize the audience seemed to have found her cold, mechanical. Following a couple of desultory questions from the head of department and a member of the selection committee, silence fell. Until finally, Jay spoke up with a series of queries that she quickly realized were designed to open up the discussion in a way that allowed her to seem warmer, more expansive. After the lecture, he approached her. I'm Jay, he said. Jay Gunasekara. He was slim, handsome, his thick black hair stylishly cut.
She shook his hand. Thank you for that.
Don't worry. It's not about you, he said, smiling. There's talk of funding cuts. They're all in a panic.
To her surprise, she found herself smiling as well. Well, I suppose that's good news.
Somewhat to her surprise, she got the position. But although she half hoped to run into him again, she had been back in Sydney for almost a month before she bumped into him amidst the evening tide of people heading up Abercrombie Street towards Redfern Station. He greeted her warmly, delightedly, and before long they were deep in conversation. When they disembarked at the same stop, he suggested they have a drink sometime, his offer so casual that it was not until later Kate realized he had been asking her out. Over the next few days, she wondered about the wisdom of her decision to accept. Although she had had occasional partners, she was usually careful to avoid possible entanglements at work. In the end, though, she went. As they got to know each other better, she came to realize how different they are. The youngest son in a family in which academic success and the ability to handle oneself socially is celebrated, Jay has always approached life with the confidence of one who believes the world is full of possibility. In the early weeks and months of their relationship, Kate found this optimism and certainty liberating to be around, even as she worried she was failing him by being unable to share in it. In time, she came to realize it was at least partly a deliberate strategy, a way of navigating a world in which he has always been, to some extent, an outsider. But as the years have passed, she has also come to suspect it is also a kind of greed, an assumption others will give themselves over to him and bend to his will.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.